following lecture was produced by Glorian Publishing, a nonprofit organization, and is one of hundreds of lectures freely available via download, podcasts, streaming radio, and transcription. These lectures range in topic and complexity in order to address the many needs of humanity. We invite you to browse our library of lectures, books, courses, and articles to find teachings that suit you. Through the support of donations, Glorian Publishing has published 40 books, hosts international retreats several times a year, offers free online courses, and many other valuable resources, available to anyone worldwide. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Your donations make it possible for this free public service to reach thousands of people every day. To make a tax-deductible donation in any amount, even anonymously, visit GnosticTeachings.org. Now, with heartfelt wishes for the end of suffering for all creatures, we begin the lecture. May all beings be happy.
Precepts of Alchemy. Compassion and Veneration. Such is the title of today's lecture, which follows the sequence of precepts of alchemy that we are studying and which are written in the Zohar. So it is necessary to listen the previous lectures in order for us to understand at the level at which we are right now. So, as you see in the title of this lecture, we find Daniel, the prophet, in the den of lions. He is there praying while the lions are looking at him with respect. He's performing what we call veneration and also compassion. If you see the Hebrew words written in blue below the holy name of God, Yod Hei Vav Hei, Va, the first letter, which means and. This word, Mora, Hom, is usually translated as fear. And the other word is also related with fear. Sometimes it says your fear and your dread, which is the same. It doesn't make any sense. But when we study alchemy and Kabbalah, we discover that the word Mora is that word that in English is called mir. It's an Aramaic word. It relates to that perfume that usually is related with death. But not, as usually we think, death of the physical body, but the psychological death that we have to suffer in order to develop compassion, which is a word that means together suffer. It's an English word. Come together, passion, suffered. And also this word passion is associated with sexual intercourse or the longing, the desire for sexual act, which is the consummation of love. It's very interesting to see the word compassion related with it and the word mir or mira, mora, in Hebrew. The different ways of translate it. So the mirror really is that gum that usually is associated when you burned in a ritual to attract the higher forces. When we study the books of the Master Samael on the Or, Igneous Rose, in that book, the Master explains that mirror relates to the different levels of the Tree of Life. That, in Sanskrit, our name, Sutala, the Vitala, Talatala, Rasatala, Mahatala, and Patala. Seven regions in the Tree of Life, which relate to all those monads of forces that come down from the solar absolute down into the earth, passing those different levels of seven regions, seven heavens, in order to reach finally the physical world, the three-dimensional world, which is Malkuth, the very bottom of the Tree of Life. That force that descends from the Ein Sof down to Malkut, or the ray of creation, is a force related with compassion. And that is studied in different levels. So, indeed, the force that can show compassion to the different souls or life in the planet is a force of love related with the spirit. In the Zohar, they always talk about the inner man that we have to develop. And in order to develop, we have to be compassionate. We have to give. But there is another force, of course, that has to be associated with that giving, with that compassion to our souls. And that is the force of veneration. That usually is always translated in the Bible as fear, dread, but really is to be in awe. Is that veneration that we have to feel towards divinity. God is compassionate and sends his force down to every soul. But we have to venerate God in order to receive it. And this is precisely the main point of this lecture, because in order to be compassionate or to exercise compassion in our life, we also have to venerate. We have to bring the force. If we want to help the poor with money, first, we have to make money. When we make the money, then we give it because we have it. We work for it. And for that, we had to be in veneration, to venerate, to worship God, who is the one that gives, that has abundance. This is very important to understand, because it's associated with the lecture. And with that graphic, when we see Daniel in the den of lions. Let me read for you what is written in the book of Daniel, chapter 6, in order for you to understand how Daniel exercised compassion and veneration in order to be helped, to be assisted, against the lions. Men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplications before his God. This was, of course, outside the den. So these men went straight to the king and reminded him about his law. Did you not sign a law that for the next 30 days, any person who prays to anyone, divine or human, except to you, your majesty, will be thrown into the den of lions? Yes, the king replied. That decision stands. It is an official law of the Medes and Persians that cannot be revoked. Then they told the king, that man, Daniel, one of the captives from Judah, is ignoring you and your law. He still prays to his God three times a day. Hearing this, the king was deeply troubled, and he tried to think of a way to save Daniel. He spent the rest of the day looking for a way to get Daniel out of this predicament. In the evening, the men went together to the king and said, Your Majesty, you know that according to the law of the Medes and Persians, no law that the king signs can be changed. So at last, the king gave orders for Daniel to be arrested and thrown into the den of lions. The king said to him, May your God, whom you serve so faithfully, rescue. A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den. The king sealed the stone with his own royal seal and the seals of his nobles, so that no one could rescue Daniel. Then the king returned to his place and spent the night fasting. He refused his usual entertainment and could not sleep in all that night. Very early the next morning, the king got up and hurried out to the lion's den. When he got there, he called out in anguish, Daniel, servant of the living God, was your God, whom you served so faithfully, able to rescue from the lions? Daniel answered, Long live the king. My God sent his angel to shut the lions' mouths so that they will not hurt me, for I have been found innocent in his sight, and I have not wronged you, your majesty. The king was overjoyed and ordered that Daniel be lifted from the den. Not a scratch was found on him, for he had trusted in his God. Then the king gave orders to arrest the man who had maliciously accused Daniel, and he had them thrown into the lion's den, along with their wives and children. The lions leaped on them and tore them apart before they even hit the floor of the den. The king Darius sent this message to the people of every race and nation and language throughout the world. Peace and prosperity to you. I decree that everyone throughout the kingdom, my kingdom, should tremble with fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and he will endure forever. His kingdom will never be destroyed, and his rule will never end. He rescues and saves his people. He performs miracles, signs, and wonders in the heavens and in the earth. He has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions. Daniel's chapter 6, 11 to 27. So as you see there, many people might think that if they have enough love to their God, it will be enough to prove it if they are thrown into a den of lions and to be saved. But this is not a matter of believing. This is a matter of alchemy and a certain level that the initiate reaches in which he has to prove that he really has that love of God in his heart. and not to accuse anyone. The lions represents the lions of the law, of karma. Every time that you see a lion in your dreams, that means karma that comes to you. People always, of course, many initiates are against the laws of karma because they apply the law according to each one of us. So, first that you see, he is in veneration of his God, means doing the work that we have to do in order for God to exercise compassion. These two forces, compassion and veneration, are related with Bina, the Holy Spirit, that receives the name of Jehovah Elohim. Or in the Bible, it's translated as Jehovah God. Bina, indeed, is that force, or is related with that soul, that in Kabbalah, in alchemy, is called Chaiah. And in the Bible, is written in different levels. Chai, life. Chaiah, the soul. Chaim, Chayot. It's always, if you find this word related with the letter Chet, which we previously explained, is a union of the letter Vav and the letter Zayin in order to form the letter Chet. And of course, Genesis 9, chapter 2, states, according to the translation that we made in relation with Mir, which means to exercise compassion from above, you see the force comes and express to yourself. But you have to grasp it. You have to venerate in order to be. This is a conjunction of two forces. That's why Genesis 9, chapter 2 says, and your compassion and your veneration shall be upon every beast of the earth. Chayot, or Chaya, is how it's written in the Bible. And upon every fowl of the air, upon that all that creeps on the ground, and upon all the fishes of the sea, into your hand are they delivered. When you read that, of course, it's after the event of Noah, when he is saved from the ark, and God tells him that all the beasts and all the Chaiah that he kept into the ark is in his hands, or in their hands. Of course, this is a profoundly alchemist. Do not fall into the mistake of believing, as the common people think, that was an ark of wood that Noah made. And actually, we think in wood, we know very well that Noah made that ark of wood, but that wood is from the tree of good and evil. Because we have to know how to control the forces also of the tree of life. That's the wood that we have to be concerned with, which is profoundly alchemical. That's why you find there the word Yod Chava, or Yod Hei, Vav Hei, in this picture, in order for us to understand that the whole work that we are doing relates to the holy name of God. That we already said, Yod Hei Vav Hei, Yod Chava, is the same Elohim in Bina, because that is the name of God in Bina, Yod Chava Elohim, one unity that we explained already in the previous lectures. So therefore, by doing this alchemical work, is how we develop that compassion in different levels. according to our veneration. This is what we have to understand. And that is always related to Chaiah. Because in Kabbalah, I repeat, we state that Chaiah, Bina, is that soul that relates to life in different levels. By venerating that Chaiah, that soul, is how eventually, if we work very hard, we will become Nefesh Chaiah, which the Bible translates as living soul. And of course, when somebody reaches the level of Nefesh Chaiah, that one controls the rest of Chaiah, the rest of animals in different levels. Because that Chaiah is with the birds of the air, with the fish of the ocean, and is also with the beast of the earth. And that is in relation with the tree of life. Because the sea of the ocean is Yesod. Chod, the beast of the earth. The fall of the air, Netzach. So we are going to study that little by little in order for you to understand how you work with it in order to gain that we are talking about. Let us now go into the second graphic, where we find this beautiful picture of Zeus with the goddess Io. And of course, we wrote in the above the face of Zeus or Jupiter, which is the same one, Io Peter. And below, Ram Io, which is a female aspect that we are talking about. Ram Io is the one who venerates Jupiter. And this is how, because if there is not veneration, for instance, and compassion, how they're going to be union? In this case, the woman represents veneration. Not because we men cannot develop that. It's not because of that. No, it's not. What happened is that Malkuth, the lower Sephira, we always repeat in a state, is feminine. So when we are praying in veneration to our God, trying to receive his compassion, his force, then we are turning into a female aspect. The female archetype in the earth is receiving the force of God. And that's why in sexual alchemy, it is stated, the man exercise opens the vagina with his phallus. And that's what represents Jupiter or Jupiter, the one that opens. Io, because he is the androgenism there, the two polarities. The man represents the one that penetrates, that opens the uterus, that in this case is Ram Io, his highest force in the name Jehovah. See the word, how it's written. The tetragrammaton, yod hei bav hei, is written there, the name of God. But in between, you find the letter het. That letter het that represents life, that represents the two polarities, male and female. In many lectures, we pronounce the name of God in this way, Jehovah. But now let us explain what is Jehovah. Jehovah is Yod Heh Vav Heh, acting through Het. Because Yod Heh Vav Heh is Yod, phallus, Hey, uterus, Vav, man, Hey, woman. And with those forces are together in one unity, that unity is represented by the letter Het, that unites the two forces of them. And then make not a tetragrammaton, but a pentagrammaton, which is Jahava. Hava is translated as Eve in English. And Yod-Heh is as Jah. In both forces, you find the two polarities united by the letter Het. So that's the real name of God when acting in life. Yah Hava. In the alchemist that transmute those forces in himself or herself. But when the Kabbalist knows this, but ejaculates the life in his sexual energy out in the orgasm, in this spasm, then he's no longer worshiping Jehovah, or that what you call Jehovah, which is a positive ray of the moon that gives life, spiritually speaking. Instead, is doing the contrary, worshiping the negative aspect of the moon that is called Hava Ja. Hava, which is Eve, the sexual organ, is ejaculating Ja out. And that is what in alchemy is called Hava Ya, which is actually the name of a demon in the internal planes, which is the contrary of Jehovah. And this is something very important, because many Kabbalists don't dare to pronounce Jehovah, but they pronounce the name of a demon, which is Havaya, the contrary. It's really stupid, right? But they do it, because it says, if we pronounce it in backwards, in that way, we are doing the right thing, because we are not pronouncing the name of God, but they are pronouncing the name of a demon that is very active in this day and age, which is Hava Yah, the contrary, which means ejaculation of the forces of God. But when you transmute it, then you are worshiping Hava Yah, which is represented here in this beautiful picture of mythology. Now we enter, after this explanation, into the nine precepts related with the initiation of Tifereth. Tifereth, as you see, is in the middle of the tree of life and represents the human soul. That soul that works hard in order to achieve self-realization. That is the soul that takes the soul of Chokhmah, which is wisdom, and does it through the two polarities that we call Abba and Ima, the father and mother. Remember that one of the commandments in the Bible said you should honor father and mother. That father and mother relates to the father and mother of the soul, not of the physicality that we have, even though we have to respect our physical parents. But the father and mother that we are appointing here is precisely Bina, which relates with the Sephira Da'at, knowledge, that we have to develop by working in alchemy. So when somebody reaches the level of Tifereth, he becomes, as we said, a true rabbi or master, Kabbalistically speaking, who enters into the way of compassion. And we already explained that in the previous lecture, how Tifereth exercises compassion towards humanity in the direct path. And of course, that's why you find here Jupiter or Jupiter and Ram Io, or as we said in Christian names, Joseph and Mary, being the receptacles of Chokhmah, which is Christ, in order for the Savior that we call Yeshua, Jesus, to enter into the womb, which is the spinal column of that master that reaches that level. So therefore, that the ninth precept is in relation with that, in order for us to understand that also the number nine relate to Yesod, which is the ninth sephira here, related with sexuality, with our genitalia. So the Zohar states, the ninth precept has reference to the poor and needy, ministering to their necessities as it is written. And Elayam, the sea goddess, said, let us make Adam in our image after our likeness. Let us make Adam. Here, the plural form of expression is used in Asya, which means action, the physical world, in order to point out that through sexual alchemy, the creation of Adam was effected by Jah, the two divine principal essences of life in Chaiah, which is the soul of Bina, symbolized as Elohim. The male in the word Elohim is read El Hayam, which means this, the God of the sea, and the female Elayam, the sea goddess. Matthew Samael on Veor, in his book The Three Mountains, he said, Eo, Isolda, the lunisolar androgen, Osiris Isis, has sparkled with terrible divinity since the profound creation of all ages. The letter I, with its deep significance, is certainly the phallus, the lingam, the Hebrew yod. The letter O is the eternal feminine, the uterus, the yoni, the famous Hebrew he. The Zohar continues. In our image is the rich, representing the male, Chaiah, the forces that are above the tree of life. After our likeness, the poor represented the female, Chaiah as well. So in this area is when we find the image and likeness. This is what we have to understand. Image is male and likeness is female. Ava and Ima, father and mother, alchemically speaking. Now, just as Vav and Zayin, the two divine joint essences of the letter Het, form with Jah a single whole life, Chaiah, so Vav He, amongst humans, ought these two classes, the rich and the poor, symbols of Vav and Zayin, the male and female life principles of the letter Het in the divine nature of their spines, the spinal column, in order to form the word, life word, Chava, by means of one sexual alchemical cooperation or common unity of Otz Chaim. Otz Chaim is the spinal column where we find the Shakti potential of Chai, of Yam, male and female waters in Malkut, which is also called Asya. So you see there, This is how the Zohar explains it. But we, of course, unveil it more for you to understand that above Yod Hey with the letterhead is Chaiah, which means life. Below here in this physical world, when we work with alchemy, when we transmute our sexual energy between husband and wife, and then we are doing it Hava. Because Vav Hey is man, woman. United with the letter Het, we find the name Hava that is commonly translated as Eve. That book of Genesis says, is the mother of the living. But we have to understand that because usually Hava, Eve, is associated only with the female body. But remember that that is not only the case. Hava is formed when the man and the woman are performing the sexual act. That's Hava. If they eat of the fruit that is forbidden, and then they transform Yahava into Havaya, the contrary. But if you transmute it, and then you will start worshiping Jehovah. And that's precisely the mystery here of the tree of life. You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree of good and evil. Otherwise, you lose your force, which is the spinal column, the tree of life. Let us continue with the Zohar, explaining that. And let our image and likeness descend over the fish of the sea in Yesod, and over the fowl of the air in Netzach, and over the cattle in Hod, and every creeping thing that through sexual alchemy creeps up throughout the middle pillar, which is the spine column, above the earth, Malkut. This is how you read it alchemically. You know, it's a statement that is addressing the alchemist. It says, let your image and likeness or compassion and veneration penetrate not only your physicality. It has to be also in Yesod and Hod and Netzach. And every creeping thing that through sexual alchemy creeps. Obviously, that is in relation with the soul of the mercury that we always talk about. If you see it in that way, you understand it. Because when men and women are sexually united, and they transmute the sexual energy, and then that creeping thing, which is fire, creeps up to the spinal column, which is the tree of life. For that we will say that creeping thing is the serpent, Kundalini, or the serpent of brass that rises in the pole. Because you are working with fire. Now the Zohar continues. Who has compassion on the poor, from his face and countenance will never fade away the reflection and glory of the divine likeness, born by the first Adam, by which he ruled and dominated the whole animal creation, as it is written. And your compassion and your veneration shall be upon every beast of the earth, the fowl of the air, every creeping thing, and the fish in the sea. Into your hands are they delivered. All this revere and bow before the compassionate and venerated presence of Adam because of the divine image imprinted thereon and is the only law of the Creator enjoined upon the animal world that instills them with fear because of this image first born by Adam. In other words, the root race that existed in Lemuria were individuals that crystallized Adam Kadmon within them. In other words, they had the image and likeness of the Elohim, Bina, within them. And any animal is always clairvoyant. When they see that image imprinted in the true human being, which is Adam, they see that with veneration and respect. But in this day and age, we think, oh, well, we are made into the image and likeness of God. I would like to see that one that stayed dead, to go to the zoo and jump into the lion's den, to see if he really, the lion, will respect him and look at him with veneration and fear. That is also translated. I don't think so. We have to gain that. That's the problem of this humanity that reads Genesis literally. And they think that the man to the image of God is already there. I would state, if that's the case, God might be very ugly. You know? Because that image is that holy thing that we had. It's called Salem within us. And to gain that, to incarnate that Salem in us, is not easy. We have other levels of Chaiah, because Chayot is animals. When we see there a being in that level, we said, well, respect, we venerate the Elohim, which are made into the image of Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh. You see there the graphic of Solomon, according to this picture, in which God is giving him his Zalim, his image, in order for him to exercise wisdom. That's the level. We talk about the level of Zaul, the level of David. But when we reach the higher level of Solomon, is that one that transmuted all the lead of his personality into gold. And of course, all the mirror, the perfume of the higher dimensions, show through them as a judge, as a great king, with compassion, because he venerates his only God inside. That's why Master Jesus of Nazareth, which is another incarnation of that compassionate and veneration, or the image and likeness represented in his life, when addressing the women of Jerusalem, he says, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never gave suck. Then they will begin to say to the mountains, follow us, and to the hills, cover us. For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Do you see that statement there? He is a green wood because he is always alive. He's an alchemist. And you see how he is treated. Because an alchemist that is always that image in himself doesn't mean that he has to mock the law. In past lives, before reaching that initiation, he was doing devil's things. Now he has to pay. And he is paying by carrying his cross, by being compassionate to the daughters of Jerusalem. Who are the daughters of Jerusalem? For that we need to know Kabbalah. Because Yod-Heh is father, mother. Up there, they call Yah. So the letter Hey, the first letter Hey appearing in the holy name of God, is the mother. But the second letter, He, which is the fourth in the holy name, Yod He, Vav He, is the daughter. This is how we study in Kabbalah. So when he said daughters of Jerusalem, he's not talking about women. He's talking about Malkuth, the physicality. We are the daughters if we are alchemists. Do not cry for me, he says. I am just helping you. But cry for yourselves, because it depends how you behave with your physicality, how you are going to be judged, and your children, meaning that you are building. Because when the alchemist is in chastity, he is being pregnant in the spinal column with Israel, with the Savior, which is fire. So those alchemists that do that, because they transmute, they have no children. Blessed are the wombs, he said, that never bear, or the barren, and never bore, because they are transmuting the sexual energy. You know, that's the meaning. Physically, you are multiplying yourself inside, and you are having spiritual development. But in the physical world, the alchemists, because they don't fornicate, they have no children. I remember in this very moment, an alchemist, a female, I talked to the master Samael on Veor and said, "Master, but I am a woman and I need to have a child. In this physical world, I have that longing." "Good that you have it," said the master, "because that's normal. But you're an alchemist. But if I don't do it, let's say that the whole world are Gnostics. How the souls are going to come?" I said, "Oh, the day that you will see that the whole world will become Gnostics, alchemists, that will be really the day," he says. No. Don't worry. Billions of women are there bringing children to the world. And you are just one among millions that are an alchemist. So what do you worry about bringing souls into the world? They're doing it. They're behaving like animals. So don't worry about daughters of Jerusalem. Remember, those daughters is the letter He, the daughter. Represents our physicality. Doesn't mean females. Also males are daughters. Because when we are in veneration, we become female. We receive. We are receptive of the compassion of God in the altar of alchemy. Of course, as you see in the next graphic, not all the masters follow the path of compassion. There are certain masters that reach the level of Tifereth, and they don't care about humanity. And if they do it, they forget about that other poor people. Poor in this way are we, that do not have a reach of knowledge. The Zohar explains. He says, the Zohar states, as long as a human, we put in brackets, bodhisattva, in order to understand what is a true human, entertains and cherishes compassion and sympathy for the poor, he will continue to bear the image and likeness, you see, the alchemist. While he exercises compassion, he is truly human. When he ceases and refrains therefrom, he becomes and continues merely an animal. Chaiah. How can this be substantiated? From the life of Nabuchodonosor, the Babylonian king, or Malakim, whose dream of his own downfall was never realized, whilst succoring the poor, the buratus, the essences, the need. Immediately he ceased from deeds of charity and compassion and suffer himself to become filled with pride of heart and vain glory, then was heard the voice of the heavenly Father, or Watcher. The kingdom is departed from thee, that is, the seal and stamp of the divine Chochmah, born by Adam, vanished from him, and he ceased to be human. His heart became changed, and a beast's heart was given him, and he was driven out from amongst humans, and dwelt within the beast of the field. For this reason, the scripture, in order to express the creation of Adam, makes use of the words, "Let us make Adam," to indicate that that to preserve the divine image, we should be charitable and compassionate, as was the rich and affluent Boaz to Ruth. You write in the book of Ruth how this Boaz, who was a rich man, took Ruth into his home, and she was poor. But this is a symbol that we have to understand. Because Boaz, if you know about Masonic rules, when you enter the temple, you say, Yakin Boaz. Boaz is the left. When you get a lot of riches, it's because you are working with the left, which is veneration. So in the Tree of Life, you find the rich in the right and the left in the left. I mean, the poor in the left. And that reaches Malkuth. So when people are poor, spiritually speaking, it's because they are lacking veneration. When you venerate, when you meditate, when you pray, is how you acquire the force of compassion. And it's you exercise compassion toward your fellow man. It's not you, the one that is doing it. You understand that? Because the ego is selfish. But it's the soul, the spirit. That's why chesed means charity, compassion. So if you want your spirit, your chesed, to exercise compassion, you have to open the doors of your heart to venerate him, your inner God, in order for him to express and to give to the poor. Not necessarily to the poor, economically speaking, in the sense of money. Because this is what people always understand it. If I have money, I'm going to give to the poor. That's good. But the main thing is to give wisdom, to give knowledge, to give the doctrine to those ignorant people that are paying a lot of karma and which are suffering a lot because they ignore about the law. If you are selfish and you don't teach, they will continue making mistakes and being always poor, not only physically, but also spiritually. And a true bodhisattva always gives. So Nabuchodonosor was one of them, but he ceased to do it. For whatever reason, because he starts boasting about himself. I am a master of fifth degree. Follow me. And being proud and vain. And this is not precisely what God wants within. And then the people turn and to start worshiping an idol. And the book of Daniel is also reading about the idol. That idol is precisely when you make of that person something that is not. You forget about your inner God. And you start worshiping somebody else. That's no good. We have to respect. Proverbs 28, verse 27-28 says, "Whosoever gives to the poor shall not want. Yet the one who hides his eyes for doing so will become a master with curses." Amarut Rabbi. When the wicked rise, his chaiah shall be concealed. But when Adam pride and vainglory in the heart perishes, the righteous, the tzaddik, increase inside of you. This is very important to understand, because remember that the Zohar states, Meorot means lights, and relates to the two lights that we work in the sexual alchemy. The two lights, the light above and the light below, or the sun and the moon. That's Meorot. But when you take from your heart the Vav, which symbol of the soul, which is a humble soul, you see, in the heart we have the sun, the symbol of Judah, or the symbol of Israel as well, the soul. When you take it out and put it before the letter Tav, and then you change completely. And instead of lights, which is Meorot in Hebrew, you had the word Marut, which means curses. In other words, a hasnamus. Because that's what happened with Nebuchadnezzar. Being a master of the fifth degree, he starts feeling vain and proud. So then he turned into a beast. In other words, the image and likeness of his inner being vanished. And the only thing that you saw there was a maruth, a hasnamus, always boasting of himself and forgetting that God is the one that does things through you. Because always the book of Genesis says, and God said. That means that God is the one that is doing the work that we are performing here in this physical world. We are just people, ordinary people like anyone. And we don't have to be worshipped. Otherwise, people will turn into ourselves into idols, and that's bad. And this is precisely what happened with those Kabbalists that like to be worshipped. And that Chavaya, which is also pronounced Chavayot, is a demon that relates to the physicality, the negative aspect of the moon, where people are just concerned with being beautiful and want to attract fans. Like any actor or actresses of Hollywood, they're always concerned with their physicality. That's Chaiah, the contrary of Jahava, which is related with the beauty inside of us, which is the soul, Tiferet, that light that we're concerned. But when we take that light out and we are not concerned with our spirit, but with our physicality, how do I look? Do I look beautiful? And then, of course, we start turning the force into the ego. And if we are fornicating and studying Kabbalah, we are worshiping Chaiah. We are not worshiping Jehovah, or Jehovah, the God of the moon, or the positive ray of the moon. Remember that. Jehovah, positive ray of the moon. Chaiah, the negative ray of the moon. Choose. Many Kabbalists in this day and age that study Kabbalah are following Chaiah, not Jehovah. And this is very important to you to know in order to find the differences of this alchemical work in relation with the ninth precept. Now, let us enter into the 10th precept. And when we continue studying more strongly, veneration, which means prayers. In Hebrew, the word tefillah means prayer. And somehow, tefillin is plural, which means prayers. And that is translated as phylacteries, which is very common among Orthodox Judaism. We are not going to go into a study that physically, but yes, physically, but alchemically. In order to understand what the Zohar explains, the 10th precept concerns the fixing and girding for devotional prayer, tefillah, or phylacteries. Thy head upon thee is like God's vineyard. The word for God's vineyard is translated as Carmel. If you see the word there, Carmel. Somebody told me, well, that means the God of Karma. Yeah, it could be also if we associate it with Sanskrit, Carmel, right? But it relates to a garden of grapes, where also the name Carmen comes from. You see there, this beautiful priestess of Dionysius in Greece that has around his head leaves of grapes forming a crown. And she is holding a staff with a pine cone, which symbolizes the mind. Of course, the tiger skin that she wears in one of her shoulders is a representation of willpower. It means that this is a priestess that was working with the positive forces of sexuality of the god Dionysius in the time of Greece. And relates, of course, to the one that is doing this work, this prayer, or tefila, tefillin, that in order to do it, you have to work with the two polarities in yourself, in your physicality. First, we have to understand that the two polarities in our physicality are related with Ida and Pingala. But when we are married, and then we work with the two polarities as well in the sexual act, by controlling the left column of the tree of life, which is also related with evil. Because that left column goes down to Malkut and even Klipoth. Through the left column is how we fall into sin. This, of course, alchemically speaking, in order to understand the two words, Adam and Eve. Thy head upon thee refers to the tefillah, or prayer, phylactery of the head, which represents the divine head, or, in other words, the divine name, Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh, of which each of the letters stands for a verse of a scripture, which placed within the four sections of spaces of the prayer phylactery of the head, correspond to the letters of the divine name. This is why we are taught by tradition that the words of a scripture, and all the people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of Yod-Heh Vav-Heh, and they shall be in awe of thee. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 10. That means when you are doing this alchemical work, your head turns with knowledge, and people wonder, from where is this man getting all of this doctrine, this knowledge? Well, from the place of where all alchemists get them, by transmuting, by being in chastity, by being righteous. Because the knowledge is there. It doesn't belong to anyone. But when you work serious in yourself with veneration, and then compassion comes. But in order to work with veneration, you have to know your anatomy, spiritual, psychological anatomy, physically speaking. Because remember that you are Eve, physically speaking. You have to receive the forces of Adam, Kadmon. So this refers only to this prayer, phylactery. The first space or compartment contains the verse. You see, this is what you find in Orthodox. They place in their head a square with certain prayers, which are associated with alchemy. It's not by writing there and putting there that you are going to receive the image of God or the information, the doctrine. No. You have to exercise, you have to practice what you write in there. And that's precisely the problem of present alchemists or Kabbalists, we would say. That they know the Kabbalah well, and they write what is had to be written there in order to receive the image, the forces of God. But in their common and ordinary life, they are fornicators. They ejaculate the Chaiah, the life of God. So how are they going to receive that? Because that is, of course, a teaching that we had to learn in order to know what to do. That's why Exodus 13, verse 2 states, "Sanctify me in every forge." This is the translation. "That which is the yod, which cleaves the womb, woman and slave, malkut, our physicality, because we are slaves of this physical world, among the children of Israel, among Adam and among Behema." That means that the children of Israel relate with the heart, those alchemists that are doing the work in the forge of the Cyclops, or in the forge of Vulcan, meaning the sexual alchemical work, because when we are in the sexual act, we feel that forge, that fire. That is what it means there. Of course, in the common and ordinary translation, they said, "Sanctify me the firstborn." Because, I mean, you can translate that in that way. But we took the alchemical translation in order for us to understand. He's talking to the alchemist. Meaning, give me what is mine in the sexual act. When you penetrate the woman, or when the woman receives the man, the one that is giving that life is Jehovah Elohim, Bina. So give me that, he says. Transmute it. Return it. This is the law of the cosmic common trogo auto ecocrat, to receive and to give. You see, veneration and compassion. So when we receive that from God in our sex, and we perform the sexual act, we have to transmute it. And that's the first thing that he receives. "Give it to me, it's mine," he says. And not only that, but also that which is belong to the behema, or the forces which are here in the solar plex. You feel that passion, that fire in your solar plex when you are in the sexual act. "Give it to me. It's mine," says God. That's precisely the forge, the fire. Even if you are single, you have to do it. But what do we do when we feel that desire, that fire, and we want to satisfy in an animal way? In order to lose the sacred force, which is life in our sexual energy. The Zohar continues stating, connoting the Shakti potential. This is the first letter of the tetragrammaton, in other words, the letter Yad, symbol of Keter, which is the first Shakti potential of the Ein Sof Or, you see? Keter is the first that appears from the Ein Sof Or, and that's represented by the letter Yad. And that force is the one that descends from Keter to Chokhmah, to Binah, to Chesed, to Geburah, to Tifereth, to Netzach, to Hod, to Yesod, ending in Malkut, our physicality. Now we have to return the force. That is precisely what the Zohar says. That Yod represent the Shakti potential, what we call Chaiah in Kabbalah or in Hebrew. Of all divine origins, the first letter Yad opens as it were the womb of the second, the He, which is the larynx, by means of which the Yad, the Shakti potential, becomes fruitful with knowledge. In other words, when Yad, when the Ein of Or gives that Yad, which is the first Shakti potential that appears in the universe, that Yad opens. You know how it opens? Do you see that shafar, it is called that horn of that animal, when you blow it? You blow it from the middle, the part that is the Yad, which is small, and opens and make a noise, right, when it go out. That is precisely, that opening is the letter He that comes from the Yad. And from that, we form the word Jah, which is the first name of God that we find in Chokmah and also in Da'at. And it appears, as you see there, in the throat. What I am doing right now, for instance, is blowing that in my mind. Or better said, God blows from above his Yad, Shakti potential, solar light, in my head, and then opens the throat, my larynx, and here I am uttering to you what I am receiving from above. That's precisely the first mystery. The Zohar continues. In the next graphic, remember that in the previous lectures we said that Enoch describes the course of Nacher, which is also in other parts of the Bible called Nachera, which means brightness, light. The celestial river of light as resembling the letter Yad, or creative Shakti potential. So, in the second space is enclosed the prayer, and it shall be when Yod-Havah shall bring forth into the land. Exodus 13:5. Referring to the second letter, the He, whose womb, the throat, as just stated, is opened by Yad, the Shakti potential. In the Sefer Yetzirah, we read, by 50 gates or openings of the celestial and concealed temple, the Yod, the light power, enters and penetrates into He, that the word sound of Jah in that through the shofar or trumpet may be heard by the heart, the Vav. I explained to you that the letter Vav is associated with hearing. So when that is happening, for instance, right now, that my Yad is opening the throat of my larynx in order to give this knowledge, then in order to receive it, you have to put in activity your heart. Because that knowledge is for your soul. That Vav is associated with your chastity, which is also Yesod. And is associated with your spinal column, which is also Vav. So study the letter Vav, and you will see that in order to listen, in order to hear the word of God, you have to be alchemically prepared, opening for that. And this is how you see it when you are working in alchemy. Then says, that, which is knowledge, in the shofar, is securely close until Yad, the Shakti potential, comes and opens it and makes it sound, the word, heard by the heart, the Vav, typifying freedom from ignorance and the enfranchisement of the slaves and bondmen. It was by the sound of the word of knowledge, the shofar, that the children of the heart, Tifereth, Israel, march out of Egypt. So will it always be hereafter, the herald of freedom and deliverance. Such is the esoteric alchemical explanation of the letter He in the throat. That. So when they blow that, which is also repeated in Israel, in many places, that blowing symbolizes the doctrine, the knowledge of Kabbalah and alchemy for the soul that received from the heart in order to be free of slavery. We are slaves of our own psychological defects, vices, and errors. It doesn't mean what the people literally think, that we were slaves in Egypt and somehow Moses came and we went out of Egypt. That is symbol. You study a lot of people trying to find prints of that Exodus, because they are interpreting everything literally, ignoring that Moses represents willpower that we have to develop inside, and the knowledge that Moses delivered at that time is that precisely the shofar that we have to work in us, in our heart, in order to be little by little in the spiritual kingdom of God, out of slavery, because right now we are slaves, psychologically speaking, spiritually speaking. So you see the picture there? That's in relation with the resurrection of Jesus. He's called the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. When that happens within you, then your inner Yeshua, your inner Savior, opens the throat and delivers the doctrine of resurrection, which is the true doctrine that we should study. It's not like people think. In the future, we will resurrect, physically speaking, with the ego very fat as we have it. The type of resurrection is just for demons. We want to annihilate first the ego and then resurrect, spiritually speaking. Let us continue now in the third space or section. The third space or section is the secret of the unity of Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh. It contains the prayer Shema. Hear, O Israel, in the sexual alchemical copulation, Yod-Heh Vav-Heh, our Elohim, is one Elohim. It contains a commentary of the letter Vav, or serpent of brass, set upon a pole, the spinal medulla, which proceeds from Jah, the union of the two letters Yod and Heh that are before it, before the Vav. Better said, before two letter Vavs, or rather, Vav and Zayin, Ida and Pingala, representing male and female nervous cords, and also male and female spines that form the shape of the letter Het. Het, Yod, and He spell Haya, which is the divine life in Yesod that descends from Jah in Da'at, and that bachelors and bachelorettes sublimate through pranayama, and what husband and wife must rise through their spines when uniting their Yod-Heh, Lingam Yoni, by means of the sexual alchemical copulation, that unites the Chaiah, or Shakti potential of them, in Malkut, the second He of Yod He Vav He, the Zohar. In regards to prayers, Master Samael Onveor stated, while in agony during his process of resurrection, why is people making too much noise in the streets? They answered him, it is because today is a religious venerating day. People are happily venerating the Virgin of Guadalupe. Then he sadly smiled and said, poor people, they do not know how to venerate the Divine Mother, the Serpent of Brass. They ignore that only by means of the transmutation of the sexual energy through pranayama or through sexual alchemy is how we truly venerate our Divine Mother. This poor humanity is so asleep, and they do not know anything about the Kabbalistic esoteric knowledge of alchemists. So, Ima Elohim, better said, Aima Elayam, must be worshipped in the forge of Vulcan, the Holy Spirit. Let us now study the next prayer. The fourth space contains words of blessings and menaces to the congregation of alchemists, that is to say, to the congregation of Israel, by the observance of the rules of scientific chastity, by which they, the alchemists, should become the happiest and most powerful amongst the people of the world of Malkut, namely. And if you will indeed obey my commandments that I command you today, to love Yod-Havah, your Elohim, and to alchemically serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, he will give his Chaiah life, the rain for your land, for your physicality. In its season, the early rain and the later rain, that you may gather, or better said, transmute your grain and your wine and your oil, and he will give grass in your fields for your livestock, and you shall eat and be spiritually full. Take care lest your heart be deceived, and you turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. Then the anger of Yod-Havah will be kindled against you and will shut up the heavens so that there will be no higher rain and the land will yield no spiritual fruit and you will perish quickly off the good land that Yod-Havah is giving you. That means for the alchemists, your land is your physicality. The rain that descends in your land is coming from above. This is a rain of light, of love, compassion, that enters when you know how to venerate God. But if you turn aside and you think, like others, says, no, this is not necessary, we can receive compassion and light being a fornicator. No. And then that light is turned aside from you. Chastity is the main thing. Because it's your physicality that you have to purify. You shall therefore lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your souls, and you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontless between your eyes. You shall teach them to your children, talking of them when you are seated in your house. I am seated in my own house right now, which is my physicality. And that's why I'm telling you, children, when you are walking by the way, I am walking the path, the way right now, of chastity. So therefore, I am teaching this to you, children. And when you lie down and when you rise, spiritually speaking, you shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates, physical body, that your days and the days of your children may be multiplied in the land that Jehovah swore to your fathers to give them, as long as the heavens are above the earth. Isn't that beautiful? Alchemically speaking, doesn't mean that you have to belong to a certain group in order to receive that. If you are performing that in your land, in your physicality, then everything is open. That's called veneration. You have to venerate, to worship only one God, and it's inside of you. With all your mind, with all your heart, with all your soul. And the neighbor as thyself. Do you see that there? Veneration and compassion? Did you see it? This is what Jesus taught. First you love, you venerate your God with your mind, with your heart, with your sex, with all your strength, sexual strength. That's to venerate. That's the first commandment. And then the second is, be compassionate. Love thy neighbor as you love thyself. Meaning the same that you are practicing, teach. So they can also develop. That's precisely the two commandments that we already talked about in previous lectures. This devotional prayer connotes the final He, or fourth letter of the divine name Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, which is formed from and by including in it the other three preceding letters, or prayers. So by studying these four aspects of the holy name of God, the tetragrammaton, is how you develop that in your physicality. This is what you have to understand. Because there are people, when I was in Israel, I was observing in the streets, a lot of Orthodox that know this, but they interpret it in the wrong way. They were wearing that phylactery in their heads and around their left arm also, which represents the left column. That means that you have to force that animality, which is the left side, the evil thing that you have within, you have to transform it. And that's why you tie that strongly around your arm. That's a symbol of Ida and Pingala in Sanskrit. You see, it's very surprising this. Ida and Pingala are Sanskrit words. But when you read it in Hebrew, Ida, that means knowledge in relation with the left side. And this is why that's the phylactery of the left. Now, let us read the conclusion of what the Zohar states. It's what we read, right? Yeah. That's we already read. Now let us go into the next graphic when we read what the Zohar states. From these observations, we may gather the occult meaning of the prayers or phylacteries or tefillin. They are really explanations of the letters of the tetragrammaton or divine name, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, in relation with sexual alchemy, and therefore the scripture states, thy head upon thee is as God's vineyard, and also, and the gate of thy head is like purple. We find this image of the god Dionysius, the god of wine, which is opposite, is Bacchus. People that utilize the wine and they get drunk, and Bacchanalia. But Dionysius is a positive aspect. the wine on transmutation that you transmute and get inebriated with the spirituality. It was taught at that time in Greece. Related also with that, of course, when the Israelites, it is written, went into the promised land and went back from it, they brought a lot of goods, a lot of grapes, because this is what it is in the promised land, the spinal column, a lot of fruit that you gather when you know how to transmute the sexual energy. And that's why God's vineyard is related with Carmel. The Bible writes it Carmel. It is this is a place where you find fruits and goods, as a garden, in other words. And then says, and the gate of thy head is like purple. Of course, it's relation with the same grapes, which are usually purple. Now, valet means gate or door. Yet in this verse, it's often translated as hair, which in Hebrew is sa'ar. That word means also a place where you find wood, wilderness, you know, but you have in your head, of course. When you alchemically transmute your sexual energy, all your forces of your sexuality, your hair turns into a wild wilderness. And do you understand the word of God there? Because your hair is becoming with your tefillin. So, dalet comes from the root word dal, signifying poverty, denoted by the prayer of the left arm, since that of the head denotes riches or wealth. And it is further added, the king is held in his plates or tresses, meaning that the divine name of Elohim is in the four compartments of the phylactery of the head. Whoever wears the phylacteries, better said, whoever transmutes their sexual energy bears the divine likeness. For as Chaiah, the divine essence of Jah, is physically Hava, as male and female sexual life, expressed in Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. So the alchemist becomes hearer of his image. Furthermore, it is said, male and female created they them. Thus, the phylacteries also symbolize the male and female sexual Hava life in Malkut, that when taken, better said, sublimated together between husband and wife, form in the sexual act one unity or whole. Such is the symbol of the phylacteries of prayers, Zohar. So this is the whole explanation of these phylacteries in the 10th precept relates to veneration. How you have to venerate your inner God in order to have that compassion develop in you. People take this literally and then think, you know, we have to love one God and not to make any image of it. And they think that God is outside of themselves. And that's wrong. God is inside. And that's why this physicality is given unto us in order to know how to worship, how to venerate God in us. Because that's the first commandment. You shall love your God with all your head, mind, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, sexual strength. When you do that, of course, in different levels, you are accumulating a lot of force from God above. And thereafter, you exercise compassion. Because God gathering you is giving the doctrine. But how are you going to gather that if you ignore the anatomy of your spiritual, psychological, physical nature? You don't know how to worship God. You think that only by believing that is one God is enough. There are many millions and billions of people that believe there is one God, Muslims and Jews and Christians. So, but they don't receive anything. Because you have to be an alchemist. You have to practice what you preach. Otherwise, you become a marut, a hasnamus. Now let us study the 11th precept. In order to understand this even better, the 11th precept has reference to the Levites, better said, the alchemists. You find the book of Leviticus in the Bible that turns about these last, which are for those that transmute. That's why you find in Leviticus a lot of sexual statements. Because this is for the alchemists that know about sexuality. People that read that literally and they are fornicators, they don't know what they are reading. Right? This is precisely for those, like in this case, us, that know about the mystery of alchemy. Then there's the rules. And the giving of tithes or grains and the product of fruit trees. Regarding the first scripture states, and Elohim said to the alchemists, behold, I have given you the Chaiah or soul of the mercury of every herb bearing zera, semen, or brewed mercury, or in other words, seed, which is upon the face of all the earth. And the Chaiah or soul of the mercury of every tree, which is in the fruit of a tree yielding zera, or brewed mercury, in other words, seed. To you it shall be for food. Do you see the beauty of this statement? We previously explained that in order to venerate God, you have to know how to transmute your sexual energy. But in order to accumulate that solar light in your sexual energy, we had to know what to eat. Because the solar light is in the seed, in the grain. And that's why bread is always worshipped. Because you make bread commonly with wheat, but other cereals also. Because in the grain is the solar light, the life, Chaiah, of the Holy Spirit, or Yahovah Elohim. But in this day and age, a lot of people, scientists, are doing stupidities with our food. You find a lot of fruit that is adulterated. How do you find the fruit? When the fruit is adulterated, the seed you planted, it doesn't give another tree. If that fruit has a seed. Because you find seedless grapes. That's stupid. In other words, the life, the Chaiah of God is not there. So you eating just the shell, masticating the thing there that in order to feed your body. But what about when you are and transmute your sexual energy? It's very clear, says the Chaiah which is in the seed, and also the fruits of the tree. So that's where you have to understand. In this day and age, we are destroying the life, Chaiah, of God. So we alchemists have to go into the supermarket or certain places in order to find that this has seed. But we know that it has seed is the life of the solar logos, the compassionate force of the Ein Sof Or going down to Malkut and feeding with solar energy, with Or, with light. And then we eat it, we got it. We accumulate it in our sexual energy, and when we perform the sexual act, we transmute it, and we give life to ourselves. We give light to ourselves. That's the rules of alchemy. But the black lodge, those demons that are crossing the fruits, are destroying our food. And now we find fruits which are bigger, very festivity for the sight, but garbage. If you are an alchemist, that's not good. That's what always we say. If that fruit that you are eating is natural, eat it. If you are going to make bread with natural wheat, eat it. That then you will have that light in you and it will multiply. That is in relation, of course, with a good thief. Because you are, as an alchemist, you become a good thief. You remember that we're a good thief and an evil thief, right? When you are transmuting your sexual energy, you are stealing from the devil, from your sexual force, the light. And this is how Jesus in the cross is looking at the right, and the right thief is telling him, remember me when you come into thy kingdom. When you come into thy kingdom is here. And when he looks at him, he says, this thief is an alchemist. He's very wise. He's transmuting his sexual energy. He's following Jah Hava. So he has a lot of force. He's stealing the energy. And he says, oh, I promise you, today you will be with me in paradise. Because you have the fuel for that. When we will see it to the left, it's another thief, the evil thief. Even though he knows alchemy and Kabbalah, he's fornicating. He's going down. Because it's a dry wood. It's not a green wood. But a dry wood. So therefore it goes down. Can know a lot of Kabbalah, a lot of esotericism, but if he's a fornicator, it goes down. It's just a fig tree. Without fruit. And behold, I have given the children of Levi, all the tenth in Israel, for an inheritance, for their service which serve even the service of the tabernacle of the congregation. And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or the fruit of the tree, is Yod-Havah, it is holy unto Yod-Havah, Leviticus. In other words, you are, of course, you have to give the tithes. You have to return, because the law is the law. We are alive here, and we are eating the force from God. If you are a priest, if you are an alchemist that are helping, okay, the 10 is for you, 10% of what is mine. In other words, you physically receive that. To God belongs that force. But if you are a priest, a Levite, in other words, you are given, so therefore you receive from God. Do you see that? If you give, you receive. If you give light, you receive light. That's the tithe. Because otherwise, we will explain about the other explanation about it. So let us go with more explanations about this 11th precept of alchemy related with the tithe in order to understand it. And the king of Sodom went out to meet Abraham. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine. Talking about this, the wine from grapes of with seed. And the bread with wheat, real wheat, right? In order to bring that to Melchizedek, who was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abraham of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which had delivered thine enemies into thy hand. And Abraham gave him tithes of all that he gathered inside. The Matzah Samael states, in its exoteric or public aspect within the Jewish legislation, The tithe is a universal obligation that all the brethren of the path have, which is to loyally contribute part of their income that should not be inferior to the tithe in a free and eligible way, in accordance to what the brethren judge to be more opportune and effective in order to support the cause of truth and justice. Like here, in order to pay the rent, in order to pay the electricity, in order to pay everything in this world, we need money. And that's why we need the cooperation of everybody in order to keep ahead with this. In other times, when they were not asking, the tithes or the government was not collecting the taxes, well, there people were bringing the seed, bringing animals, and the priests, the Levites, were eating, receiving that in order to support themselves physically and to keep preaching. But in this day and age, I don't think that you will bring a hen here, it will resolve the problem, right? Or even though it's welcome, you bring a corn or whatever, right? But we need cooperation in order to support this school. And every school, every religion, always receives help in order to sustain it. The Master says, the tithe in its esoteric or secret aspect symbolizes the scale of payments in the sphere of Neptune. It is unquestionable that here we had to arrange affairs with the enemies of the King Lycos, the lords of karma. It is undoubtable that we assassinated the god Mercury, Hiram, and it is not possible to resuscitate him within ourselves without previously having paid for this abject crime. Therefore, the tithe becomes practical and necessary complement of the dynamic principle which emanates from the profound study of the Ten Commandments. You shall not covet the neighbor's goods. In other words, we must consider the mysterious yad. You see, we talked already about the yad, which is the Shakti potential, which is hidden in the middle of the central delta, the river, the sanctuary of our being, as a fountain, spring, and a spiritual providence of all the interior and divine centers of our life. This point of the tithe is clarified with the words of the gospel. But lay up for yourself treasures in heaven, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Bring ye all the tithes unto the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now herewith, said the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour in you a lot of blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Here, you find that we wrote in the Tree of Life the sphere of Neptune, the empyrean. Kabbalistically, that's the highest aspect of Keter, in the world of Yetzirah, the world of formation. Meaning that when you go up from Malkut to Keter, in the world of formation, which is the world of Yetzirah, there you had to pay the tithes to the god Neptune. You might say, why the god Neptune? Who Neptune has to do with it? Well, Neptune is Poseidon. Poseidon is the god of the water. And many times we have spoke a lot about Elohim, the god of the water, and Helayam, the goddess of the water. That is in relation with Neptune. in relation with Keter. Why? Because we explain that Yetzirah is ruled by Keter. Chochmah rules Bria, and Yetzirah is ruled by Bina, which is in the pineal gland, in which we find the atom of Neptune that controls the sexual waters. So when we place Neptune in Keter, it is in the world of Yetzirah. This is how you have to understand it. In the world of formation. Because if you study the four worlds of Kabbalah, Atzilut, Bria, Yetzirah, and Asia, this is how you understand it. We are in Asia, which is the world of action and matter. And we have to control, to sexual alchemy, the forces of Neptune, which is are the forces of the Holy Spirit. When we do it, we rise the energy to the pineal gland. And this is how we acquire knowledge. This is how we develop inside. And this is how we finish with this 9 and 10, 11 precepts, according to the Zohar of alchemy. Do you have questions?
So you opened up with a story about Daniel. I was having a little difficulty understanding the archetype represented by King Darius in that story. Because King Darius, he seemed compassionate in Daniel, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he rejoiced when Daniel successfully made it out of the lion's den. But he also passed this law saying worship only me, and then he criticized Daniel for not following that law when Daniel worshipped his god instead of King Darius. So what's going on with King Darius?
The king, you see, a malachim. In other words, is a master of the fifth degree.
So it's like Nebuchadnezzar.
Like Nebuchadnezzar, exactly. Because Darius was the son of Nebuchadnezzar. But anyhow, this is a symbol of about initiation. Darius, of course, was in his kingdom, like in any kingdom, and being organizing the Persian kingdom at that time, right, of Daniel. But there were a lot of people that were envious of Daniel. And they were the one that came to Darius and says, "Hey, we should give you respect because you are the king. What do you think if we make a law for 30 days, only 30 days? Like whoever doesn't worship you, we will throw to the lion's den." And then Darius said, "Oh yeah, it's a good idea. I need respect." But they did it in order to hurt Daniel. So Daniel, when he heard that, he continued doing the worshiping, because when he initiates in the path, you have to worship only one God. Oh, but the king. Okay, well, the king says, "I don't care. It's my God," you know? And also represents the intellect also, because the intellect is the king of this world. And that's why Darius recognizes that Daniel is a great prophet, has a lot of knowledge, and he's from God. But here, his enemies made him to write that law in order to hurt him. And now he has no choice. You sign it, king, so, well, throw Daniel into the den of lions. Right? And then that's why he was worried about it. Because he recognized it was a master. And because he controlled, and this is precisely an initiation, when you reach the level of the sphere of Neptune, you pass through that initiation, in which you are thrown in the internal planes into the den of lions. If you don't pass that, it's because you don't have the compassion that you need to develop. I remember Master Samael on the Or in his time. He said to me, not to me, but other missionaries at that time, "I'm talking to you about how to meditate here and how to comprehend that meditation is the way, and I do that. But let me tell you one thing. I am at the level of Neptune right now, and I had to pay my tithes. But before that, I had to pass a certain ordeal, which is to be in the den of lions." They put me in the ordeal already three times, and I didn't pass it. I don't know, he says, but you might say, oh, this is easy. No, no, I said, I would like you to see if a lion enters right now into this room. One lion, he says. If you are going to not to be afraid, because this is a wild beast. But not one, but a den, I mean a pride of lions. It's not one, many. And I didn't pass it. And I'm meditating. And I'm trying to inquire why I am not passing the ordeal when I have no ego already. Something that I am missing, and I don't know yet. But finally, he passed it. Because he discovered that he should show compassion to the lords of karma. Because when you are at that level, they come to you and they say, you owe this. And then you hear, oh, again, please forgive me. No, you have to pay it. This is the law. And then you have to face the lions of the law. And every time that he was there, he was not feeling so blissful with the lions because he didn't develop that love towards karma. This is precisely what we have to develop. If they are collecting me this debt, it's because I did something wrong. So therefore, I don't have to show animosity to the one that is collecting it. It's not his fault. He's just accomplished with the law. He's a judge of the law, a police of the law, and you have to face. But when in the internal plane you see a lion enter into your room, I have many experiences with that. I'm really afraid because I know if I am awakened, I know that there's karma that is against me. And to say to the lion, okay, thank you for coming. I owe something. No problem. But to feel that in the entirety of your being is not easy. And that's precisely being Daniel. When you are really venerating your own God and you understand and completely awake your consciousness in that way, even if you don't have ego, you have to develop your soul too. Then you pass your deal. And that's precisely the in relation with the laws of karma. You have to love your neighbor as thyself, right? Well, the collectors of karma are also your neighbor. But right now, with the ego alive, I don't think that you will love your neighbors, right? You have another question.
When you were talking about the horn and the shofar, and you said the yod opens up the hay and the throat and the ad, it talked about opening up the 50 gates. Is that the 50? Is that related to the pentalpha?
Yeah, it's related to the 50, yeah. Is in relation with the pentalpha, or the five aspects of the Divine Mother. Because remember that the letter He represents the feminine aspect of God. And God, as feminine, has five aspects that we study, which are the five aspects of the Divine Mother, which is the Mother Space, Mother Nature, Mother Death, your mother inside you, psychologically, spiritually, and the Fairy Mother that relates with magic. Those are the five aspects of the Divine Mother, the hay, or above, right, of the shofar. Because if you see that horn that usually they use in order to blow has the shape of the letter yad, but it's closed. When you blow it, you open it, and then it is the word, the knowledge that comes. That's in relation with, of course, with the 50 gates. It means that you have to open the 50 gates of knowledge and wisdom in yourself in order to reach that level. In the world of Yetzirah, world of formation. Another question?
So in one of the previous slides, like towards the beginning, you had this quote from Proverbs that says, if you hide your eyes or turn your eyes away, that's you become a cursed rabbi. Is that to hide your eyes from God? Is that what that was referring to in that quote there?
a cursed rabbi, or I mean, translating that as a master, right? Because rabbi means master. When you are serving and you can give the doctrine, but you don't give it, you are turning your eyes from the poor.
Oh.
So therefore, because you are turning your eyes from the poor, God doesn't give you knowledge, doesn't give you doctrine. Even if you were the phylacterist, right, in yourself, because this is precisely what faithfully all of these Kabbalists do in order to receive the doctrine. They put all of them in themselves, but they don't give. They think that to give is just go to the neighbor and give, physically speaking, some chickens or money to support this and that, which is also given. But what the Zohar explains there is the doctrine, light, wisdom. This is how you receive. If you don't give this doctrine, for instance, this knowledge that I meditated many days, and all of that that the Zohar was written about, and I receive it, and I receive more, but I give what I think you daughters of Jerusalem are capable of understanding. And I hope you are understanding in this lecture what I'm trying to say, you know what I mean? Because compassion and devotion is something that goes with the two columns of the Tree of Life. When you control the middle column, which is the central column, which is your spinal column. Mm-hmm. Remember that. You want to receive, you have to give. Because God gives, that's the law of sacrifice. You want me to enlighten you, to give you light? Give to the poor. Meaning, to the ignorant, that do not, that they don't have riches in heaven. Because in this day and age, we have only riches in this physical world. You find a lot of millionaires, people that are worried about making dollars and more dollars in order to be millionaires. But don't worry, nobody worries about to be rich in heaven, to receive the doctrine, to see heaven, to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Nobody worries about that. Because they are just concerned with the physicality, not understanding that when we die, we don't take anything from this physical world. Only the doctrine, the knowledge, the wisdom that we developed inside, in the soul, that we take. For in this physical world, we don't take anything. There's a lot of people that says, the master says, we have to resolve one equation. The half of the equation is to survive in this physical world. The other half is to develop wealth in the kingdom of heaven. People usually resolve the first part of the equation. And they get money, they got a house, they got this, that. But they get identified with that first part of the equation, and they forget about the second part. So when they die, they leave everything here, and they take to the other world, and they are examined. What did you build internally? But in the physical world, I had this building. We don't care about that. We care about your spirituality. You have zero. Go back. And they come back again to make more money. That's the problem. Thank you very much.
To learn more about what you learned in this lecture, we invite you to explore the books published by Glorian Publishing, available from booksellers worldwide. You may also be interested in online courses or upcoming retreats, all of which you can learn about at GnosticTeachings.org. All of this has been made possible by the financial support of listeners like you. Will you help others to benefit from this knowledge? Most spiritual schools recommend a donation of $10 to $20 per lecture. Every donation helps. Make a donation now at gnosticteachings.org. Thank you. May all beings be happy.